KUAM News Headlines is presented by Calvo's Insurance, serving Guam for 80 years. And brought to you by Matson and the Adahi Tonu Program. Cars Plus, reminding you to put your phone down while driving. Distractions won't get you there. Heads up, Guam. IP&E, fueling excellence. McDonald's of Guam, I'm loving it. And King's Restaurants, always open, always local, and serving up favorites for over 40 years.
Coming up right now on Primetime, millions of dollars for military buildup projects on Guam diverted for Trump's border wall. Plus tonight, why one senator wants to know why the Department of Corrections has not used federal money that they received 3 years ago. And also, the congressman may have filed his reports, but the GEC says Mike Sinicholas is not off the hook just yet.
Good evening, friends. I'm Jason Silas. These are tonight's top stories. Well, citing a national emergency, the Defense Department announced that some $3.6 billion will be diverted from military construction projects to help build President Trump's southern border wall. This includes nearly $260 million for eight projects related to the Guam military buildup, as Nestor Contawaz in our top story.
A memo from Defense Secretary Mark Esper states that the money is for 11 barrier projects that will deter illegal entry along the U.S.-Mexican border and will also reduce the demand for DOD personnel and assets along those locations. Building the wall was also a key campaign promise of President Trump, who declared back in February of this year that a national emergency exists requiring the use of armed forces. Secretary Esper approved the use of unobligated military construction funds and released a list of affected international and domestic military construction projects. On Guam, those include $56 million for a water well field, $52 million for earth-covered magazines, and $50 million for a machine gun range. A spokesperson for Joint Region Mariana says the projects have been extended, but they have not been canceled. Several billions of dollars in funding for the Marine relocation to Guam is shared by the U.S. and Japanese governments through a memorandum of agreement. No response yet from the military about any impact to that MOA. For Guam's News Network, I'm Nestor Leconto.
Elsewhere, DOC has 3 weeks to use it or lose it in reference to federal money awarded to the agency 3 years prior that till this day has been hanging in the balance. As Adriana Cotero reports, the committee vice chair on public safety wants answers.
The Department of Corrections has until September 30th to use a $250,000 grant awarded 3 years ago by the Department of the Interior.
I don't know why there's no action being done.
The grant money is supposed to go toward hiring a company to conduct an assessment and master plan to ensure safety and the future growth of DOC. Since 2016, two RFPs have gone out, the first in 2017 but was pulled back due to technical issues, and the second issued in December. According to Vice Chair of Public Safety, Vice Speaker Talina Nelson, time is simply running out.
There has been concern, however, that delay of opening up the cost packet, if the proposal even still stands, because it takes 180 days before that proposal expires. So that's one concern. Another concern is perhaps we are waiting for NIC, the National Institute of Corrections, to see if they can do the master plan. But the challenge is, are they even capable of doing that? Is that really their function?
KUAM asked DOC Director Samantha Brennan for an update on the latest RFP. She responds, it's currently under review and, quote, cannot comment further, end quote. The vice speaker, however, wants some answers and as of Thursday sent out a Freedom of Information request over to DOC.
The FOIA that we sent to Department of Corrections involves the incidents that have occurred since January 2019, and so we wanted to have a better understanding of the challenges that they have, like what was the cause for the erroneous releases, who was in charge at the time, what was the chain of command, what is their procedures. Another one was, what was the cause for our officers getting attacked by inmates?
According to Vice Speaker Nelson, she wants information about staff and SOPs that haven't been updated since the 1990s to get a better understanding of the needs at DEPCOR.
Because there is lack of training at DOC and there needs to be best practices put forward, and that master plan will lay that out also for the officers and provide avenues for additional training to improve standard operating procedures.
Eventually, Vice Speaker Nelson will hold an oversight over the agency, but for now she's hoping DOC won't be locked out of $250,000 in free money.
To lose DOI grant money because of lack of attention is just not a reason why.
Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Adriana Cotero.
Adriana also adds, in order for the project to begin, an official contract for the master plan must be drafted, reviewed, and signed by the vendor, the AG, and the governor before October. Well, some nearly $70 million in federal income tax advance payments will be signed over by the Interior Department next week. Another $18 million will be deposited with the Treasury for the Guam World War II Claims Fund, but it's money GovGuam cannot touch yet. Under the 2017 National Defense Authorization Act, collections above a certain threshold are set aside for war claims payments, but because of a technical flaw, the money can't be released. Legislation was passed by the House, but still awaits action by the Senate, meaning more than $24 million deposited with the Treasury cannot be dispersed to claimants. Governor Lou Leon Guerrero encouraged the senators to pass a bill to pay war claimants locally while they wait on Congress, adding, while we're only concerned that we may be distracted with other matters, I trust that Congressman Mike Sinicolas is working closely with the Senate committee to pass the legislation next week. Interior Assistant Secretary Doug Dominich announced the transfers today ahead of his visit to Guam later this month. Well, not off the hook yet is what the GEC is saying about Congressman Sinicolas after it filed required reports to the GEC 8 months late. Here's Chris Barnett.
As we reported Monday, the Guam Election Commission sending a letter to Guam Congressman Mike Sinicolas and his sister Faith, who happens to be his treasurer. That letter saying failure to file required reports could result in misdemeanor charges and up to a $10,000 fine. At issue, non-filing of the Congressman's 2018 year-end campaign finance report and 2019 April and July quarterly reports. Sinicolas is required by federal law to file with the GEC, which is the state office of the Federal Election Commission on Guam. Sinicolas Campaign Committee Chair and District Director Jennifer Nguyen beating the GEC deadline by 30 minutes. But according to GEC Director Maria Pangilinan, that doesn't mean the congressman is off the hook if the reports don't add up.
That would be up to the Guam Election Commission. What was submitted would be reviewed, and based on that review, it would be up to the Guam Election Commission.
Meanwhile, John Paul Manuel, Sinicolas' former chief of staff and campaign chair, alleges the congressman misused campaign funds for an affair with his mistress. He also alleges our congressman would routinely use campaign funds to reimburse himself for personal purchases. Manuel is calling on the GEC to audit Sinicolas' campaign finances.
When the GEC does an audit of his campaign, they should be able to provide all images of all the checks, all the receipts for everything that was spent. And, you know, if he doesn't have anything to hide, certainly he shouldn't have anything to fear.
An interesting turn of events now is when, in a letter to the GEC sent with the late reports, says Sinicolas' campaign is having issues with its campaign finance filings. Nguyen's letter says responsible Guam is, quote, in the process of rebuilding the data files for campaign finance reports for the April to November 2018 period. Nguyen's letter says, quote, the 30-day post-election report and all subsequent reports will be amended as soon as the prior data files are rebuilt.
Have you ever heard the term rebuild the data
relative to campaign finance reports?
It's the first time I've heard it.
According to the Federal Election Commission, rebuilding data is a process for compiling lost campaign finance information. We emailed Nguyen for clarification, but Sinicolas and his staff don't respond to KUAM. Nguyen's letter says the FEC software was not accessible to new campaign staff and that GEC notices were sent to old campaign staff. We asked Manuel if the congressman was blaming him for campaign finance reporting issues, and Manuel said, quote, it's funny, for a guy whose slogan is Responsible Guam, he never takes responsibility for himself. We asked Pangilinan if a request to audit Sinicolas' campaign was something the GEC would entertain.
Any member of the public can review the reports first and foremost, and if they have any requests, those requests will be processed through the board of the Guam Election Commission.
Interesting to note, if Sinicolas' campaign is rebuilding its campaign finance data for the time frame Manuel was campaign chair, how accurate would an audit actually be? Meanwhile, the GEC is not alone in asking questions about the congressman's campaign. The Federal Election Commission has sent letters to the Sinicolas campaign in May, June, and July of this year. One letter cited Sinicolas' raising of funds for the next election, even though he didn't file a statement of candidacy for the 2022 campaign. Another letter, a failure to file notice, indicating a fine will be issued to the campaign since there is no grace period for late FEC filings. San Nicolas's July quarterly was filed nearly 2 weeks late. In an email to KUAM, the FEC said fines must be voted on by the FEC board. Their next meeting is on September 13th. For Guam's News Network, Chris Barnett reports.
All right, thanks so much, Chris. Well, people typically seek refuge at church, but evidently 33-year-old Christopher Didasco saw it as a target and was busted for burglarizing St. Anthony's Church in Timuning. Last month, he allegedly pried open a donation box and took what was inside and is also accused of stealing a speaker. Police tracked him down by viewing surveillance video, with the owner admitting she drove Didasco to the church and then he intended to take as much things as he could. Well, Wednesday, police responded to a residence in Talofofo where they found a woman who appeared distraught and crying. She told police the man known to her ran towards her and hit her with a closed right hand on the back of her head and neck. He threw her to the floor and began to choke her while saying, "I'm going to kill you." She feared for her safety, saying the man was on medication and acts crazy on occasion. 21-year-old Troy Allen Uggen Morrison was charged with strangulation as a felony and misdemeanor family violence. Please stay tuned. We're back after this.
Get up-to-the-minute news, plus access to alerts, streaming radio, promotions, and more on your mobile device by downloading the KUAM News mobile app, available at the App Store now.
Half the day, I'm in the club.
Half the day, welcome to Two Lovers Point.
Half the day, I'm in the club.
Now there's a technology that's lighting the way to a new mortgage for people all across Guam. Introducing Simplify Mortgage by Bank of Hawaii, Hawaii's leading lender. Simplify Mortgage by Bank of Hawaii lets you apply for a home loan anytime from any device, making the mortgage and refi process faster and easier. Or work hand in hand with one of our residential loan experts. So put the power of choice and control in your hands. Simplify Mortgage by Bank of Hawaii. Welcome to tomorrow.
Okay, so what are we thinking today?
I just need a trim.
Okay, well, luckily you are in great hands.
Perfect.
The $1 stylist deal.
Is that it?
That's it.
Or you could get a real deal. McDonald's buy one, get one for a dollar deal is here. Buy one of your faves, choose another for just an extra buck. Choose from the Big Mac, filet of fish, quarter pounder with cheese, and 10-piece chicken McNuggets, but only for a limited time.
It's a special delivery to your inbox every week with your KUAM News Roundup, program advisories, and promotions. Sign up for the weekly KUAM Digital Digest today on KUAM.com.
Your Attorney General has filed a complaint in the Superior Court against eight manufacturers of chemicals known as PFAS, which is a common substance in firefighting foam that's since been found to be harmful. The suit charges the companies, including 3M, DuPont, and Tyco Fire, of injuries to natural resources, namely contamination of groundwater. Yesterday, the Consolidated Commission on Utilities passed a resolution authorizing the Waterworks Authority to join the litigation brought by special counsel hired to represent Guam in the class action suit, including multiple states. The lawsuit filed today also charges the companies with deceptive trade practices for false and misleading ads and selling of the products. The Attorney General is seeking a jury trial and to hold defendants liable for all costs to investigate, clean, and remove these substances resulting from their products. In education news, the Guam Department of Education is released of another special condition by their federal counterparts. Our Adriana Cotero spoke with Superintendent John Fernandez for an update.
We had seven special conditions that we were placed under, and because of those conditions, we have to pay a third-party fiduciary agent. It's been up to $4 million a year. I think now we've lowered it to $2.5 million.
Money that could be used every year for classroom improvements and school needs. But in order to access federal money, this has become a requirement and heavyweight on Guam Department of Education. Superintendent John Fernandez says over the past couple of years, the agency has worked toward removing these seven special conditions. And as of last month, they have been released of the fourth condition, to have a single audit.
We've been able to meet this requirement for many years, but over the past 6 years, we've seen a very strong performance for the department. So that means, you know, clean audits, no material weaknesses, no question costs. And then we kept wondering, why is this condition still there? We iterated that request this summer and said, look, this is all the evidence. We have the support from our external auditors, from OPA, Everybody recognizes the improvements, so USDOE ought to do that too. So we were lucky to get communication back that that fourth special condition is now removed.
The remaining three conditions are the more critical ones, Fernandez explains.
These are all the matters related to procurement, our fixed assets inventory, looking at how we're managing our grant compliance and so forth.
GDOE plans to report their progress by the end of this calendar year in the hopes of officials returning for an on-site visit in January 2020 to validate the removal of all the conditions. But before doing this, there is a head position to be filled. As the department's longtime deputy for finance and administrative services, Tyling Titano, is stepping down. Titano has accepted a position at Guam Waterworks Authority.
In addition to congratulating her on her, her next career move, because she's been here almost 10 years, is to also find someone who can fill her shoes and carry us forward, with the same pace, the same energy, and I think that'll be our big test. And I'm eager to show the U.S. Department of Education that it is a matter of teamwork moving us forward and not just any specific individuals.
Interested candidates can view the full job description online at www.gdoe.net before September 30th. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Adriana Cotero.
All right, thanks so much, Adriana. Lots of local celebrities in that story. Well, elsewhere tonight, the 2020 census is expected to infuse almost $14 million into the local economy and create up to 900 jobs. But it's going to take the cooperative efforts of the entire island. Here's what you can expect.
The Bureau of Statistics and Plans is in full swing, gearing up for the decennial anniversary of the Guam Census. With just 7 months left to prepare, BSP Director Tyrone Titanol is expecting to hold the grand opening of the census office in Tumuning next month.
Now, over the next few months, what we're focusing is setting up the logistical base for when we go out into the field and count every house and count every person.
Titano says that educating the public on the significance of the census, like how our population is factored into what types of federal programs we can access, and the total amount of federal funding Guam receives. But first he wants to focus on how the process works.
We're sending out people to show up in people's neighborhoods. And a lot of it is working with the grassroots organizations and the mayors. And also one message we want to get out is to explain to people how the information they provide, the census enumerators, is federally protected.
As for the recruitment of the hundreds of enumerators, BSP is working with the administration to coordinate with relevant GovGuam agencies, and Titano plans also to hold at least one job fair. One interesting project he's putting together is called Statistics in Schools.
We've already contacted DOE and a number of the private schools about incorporating information about the census into the curriculum, either in the fall semester or the spring semester. And so in that way, we sort of help promote the knowledge about the census, and hopefully add to the educational experience of the students involved.
The task is arduous between setting up logistics, hiring, and actually collecting the data. The director plans on getting the assistance of NGOs and the private sector.
One of the things that will come out of the census is a count of how many actual houses there are on the island and where they're located here. So we plan to reach out to commercial groups here, like the Realtors Association. So this is really a community project here, and we want to involve as many components of the community as possible in not only understanding what's going on, but helping smooth the way to get this done.
He plans also to reach out to leaders in the various and diverse ethnic communities to seek their help in spreading the word. Titano's goal by the end of next year is to come up with an efficient and effective 2020 census that will count every person on Guam.
Well, 3 months after making a big splash about its reopening, the Agana Pool is closed again. Parks and Rec emergency repairs are needed to ruptured sand filter tanks, with normal operations expected to resume either Friday or Saturday. The pool was closed downtown for 5 months for maintenance issues prior to reopening this past May. Residents are advised to use the pool up the street from us in Dedeo for the time being. Well, please stay tuned. Dave Delgado is up next with a night in Island Sports.
At the mall, as you enjoy your shopping, dining, or entertainment, you could also win 3 great cars from Atkins Kroll and thousands of prizes in Micronesia Mall's Cars, Prizes, and Getaways game. Present your mall receipts and have a chance to win the renowned performance Chevrolet Camaro, the unapologetic rugged Toyota 4Runner, or the head-turning Lexus ES350 Luxury. Getaways to Manila, courtesy of Philippine Airlines, plus prizes from Foot Locker and Burger King. The more you shop, the more chance to win in Micronesia Mall's Cars, Prizes, and Getaways game.
Mattson is in this community. We've been in this community for decades. We're gonna be in this community for decades to come. Things will get busy, things will get quiet, but we're gonna be here. We're your hometown carrier. And that matters to us.
Reliability is the core of our business. We take pride in ensuring that we arrive in Guam on time as scheduled.
It's our local employees who understand the market, who understand the business, and provide that hard work for you each and every day.
When we hold ourselves to high standards, our customers also hold us to high standards. We establish good business relationships that turn into friendships. That's why it's so important to be here and be trusted by your customers. We want you to trust Mattson like your friend, like your family.
KUAM Sports is presented by Triple J.
What's up, Guam? Dave Delgado here for KUAM Sports. Thanks for watching. I'll get to some black belt highlights from this year's Marianas Open. But first off, women's football news on a former GWTFL player turning pro stateside. Check it out.
Huge shout out to Irish Iriarte Jones, who was recently drafted by the Houston Stampede of the Women's Football League Association. Irish was selected in the first round, fifth overall at this year's draft. Jones will be suiting up at outside linebacker for the Stampede.
So as of right now, I'm given an NFL sports agent. I basically have to talk with him and start something up with him, and then after that, I can go ahead and talk to the Houston Stampede owners and see what they're offering. And this league, the lowest that a team owner can pay you is $25,000. So it's big money right now, and it's something serious. I mean, the top three girls that got picked were offered $5 million, $5 million, and the third girl got $2.5 million.
Jones graduated from Simon Sanchez in 2009, where she played safety and tight end for the Sharks. She also played four seasons with the Lady Falcons in the Guam Women's Tackle Football League. Irish also played two seasons in San Diego for the San Diego Surge and San Diego Rebellion. Her times and work ethic at the Combine turned heads and gave her the edge on draft day.
From then on, it was like, well, you know, if I can make it in the Women's League here, what happens if I go to the U.S. and play? So that was really what happened. I got to the U.S., and it was like, oh, they have actual leagues out here that are way bigger than what it is back home, because they travel from state to state. And, you know, from there, it was just like, well, it was just a passion thing. And then it came out, and it was like, well, we're looking to pay women to play. So it was like, oh, women to play? I don't get paid to play for these leagues, so why not? So from then on, it's like, you hone in on your skills, and if that's what you want to do, you got to do it.
The WFLA will feature 32 teams split into an Eastern and Western Conference. Teams will play an 18-game season with four wildcard playoff games, four divisional round games, two conference championship games, and one Diamond Bowl. Kickoff for the league is scheduled for August 2020. Hats off to Steve Shimizu and the crew at this year's Marianas Open, the competitors and gyms for prepping their students, and especially Duke Urbano for the highlights. Marianas Open black belt absolute champion was Kanan Duarte out of Atos Jiu-Jitsu in San Diego, California. He's also the current world champion. Duarte defeated teammate Ronaldo Jr. Kanan advanced after securing the Black Belt Division II with a win over Purebreds Javier Morales. Ryder Heisem, representing Carpe Diem, placed third in the division. Ronaldo Jr. bagged the Black Belt Division I before losing to Duarte in the absolute fight. Alliance Guam fighter Jose Souza out of Brazil placed second. Third place went to South Korea competitor Insung Jang, representing Wire Jiu-Jitsu. Black Belt Division I and II champ bagged $3,000 each. The Brown Belt Absolute winner also took home cash as well. Along with that cash money, they each received belts for their wins. Kanan Duarte earned a free trip back to Guam to defend his title at the next event. Competitors can mark their calendars now for the Marianas Pro as the show heads back to Japan in December. In youth football, the Guam Raiders improved to 3-0 this season in the Mega Division behind the team's 22-0 win over the Angels. Running back Tristan Burgos scored twice for his team in the win. The Raiders have three shutout wins this season and will next face the Steelers on September 15th. In programming news, make sure to catch the kickoff of this year's NFL season right here on the stations of KUAM. Friday, September 6th marks the 100th year of NFL action. Khalil Mack and that tough Chicago Bears defense will put Aaron Rodgers and the Green Bay Packers offense to the test. Kickoff set for 10:15 in the morning on KUAM TV8, NBC Sunday Night Football.
Introducing Triple J's Online Shopper, the new, faster, easier way to purchase your next vehicle. Explore hundreds of new and used vehicles in full 360-degree view. Get pre-approved instantly from the comfort of your home or office. Personalize your own finance terms and get top market value on your trade-in in just a few quick, easy steps. Buy with confidence from start to signature, and we'll even go the extra mile to deliver your vehicle to your home or office. Have a question? Our sales team is just a chat away for instant assistance. Click, pick, drive. Complete the entire car buying process with Triple J's Online Shopper and purchase your next vehicle at triplejguam.com today.
Can I just get a ride back?
A beautiful, healthy smile is an expression of confidence. The more confident you are about your smile, the more likely you are to fully express your feelings without having to worry about the way your teeth look.
Before cosmetic dentistry, I didn't smile as much. I didn't have the confidence, and it shows. And since I've had cosmetic dentistry done, I feel 10 times more confident. I make my initial introduction with a nice big smile and a handshake, and I just, you know, feel like it really is a relationship builder, a nice warm smile, and it makes the clients and customers feel more comfortable with you, feeling confident, and they feel that you're not just there for business, that you're also there kind of as a friend as well. So, I mean, it's amazing how powerful a smile can be. A good smile.
Since your smile makes a significant impression on those around you, it is important that it makes the impression you want it to make.
It's been coming for some time.
Well, that is Guam native John Cruz, a sergeant with the Titusville Police Department in Florida, who was patrolling a park when he noticed a resident observing the weather and strumming his guitar. After striking a conversation with the person, it led to an impromptu jam session with the classic song by Creedence Clearwater Revival. We all love that. The video clip, which has been viewed over 83,000 times, was posted on the City of Titusville's page on Facebook and shared with us by his proud parents, John and Carol, of Inarahan, along with several family and friends. Really, really cool. Check us out on Instagram to add your comments to that wonderful clip. All right, time now for your birthday shoutouts. Let's do some birthdays, shall we? Happy birthday to Noelle Mons, the very beautiful 21-year-old KUAM kid. We love you and we miss you, say all of us here at KUAM and your family. Elvin Jeremiah Babalta has a birthday today, and it is Elvin's birthday number 12. This comes from your sisters Rhea, Raquel, and the Babalta Jerez family. Also, happy birthday number 10 to Amara Danielle Daga. Happy birthday, Mara, coming from Mommy, Daddy, Naya, Danica, and the entire family, and they say enthusiastically, we love you. Go to KUAM.com to register for the Cold Stone Creamery Birthday Club. Well, no more paper, no more stories, but please stay tuned. Sabrina is up next with In the Mix.